So we finished exploit exercises protostar a while ago, which means we have a really good basic understanding of how binary exploitation worked many years ago. Exploitation nowadays is not as easy anymore, and some of you have noticed that because you tried to copy the source code and compile it on your own modern Linux machine. So I thought it would be interesting to start introducing modern techniques and exploit mitigations by revisiting some of the protostar challenges on a current Ubuntu, and see how far we get. Are they still exploitable? So let's have a quick look at the very simple source code again. There were these variables, a buffer and this modified integer, which was set to 0. Then there was this gets function, which reads in some input into the buffer, and it doesn't have a way to check the length. So this way, we were able to fill the buffer completely and even write beyond it into the adjacent memory. The binary on the old protostar VM had the modified variable just after the buffer. Thus, if you wrote more than 64 bytes, you overwrote the zero value of the modified variable and thus changed the outcome of this if. So let's try this again on a modern system. I'm using DigitalOcean to quickly spin up a new Ubuntu machine and SSH into it. Then I take the code and compile it. New system, so we have to install GCC, the compiler. Now it works. You can already see that the compiler is warning us of the use of gets. You see, making programming mistakes like this really requires a developer to ignore warnings like this. You don't really have to know about the dangers from somewhere else anymore, it tells you right away. So let's see. Let's try to input a lot of characters and see if we can change the modified variable. But it doesn't seem to work. The only thing we can get is a stack smashing detected error, and the process is aborted. That's the first evidence that a bit more stuff is going on here. So let's look at the assembly code that the compiler produced. First of all, let's check why we couldn't overwrite the modified variable. Does a stack smashing detected have to do anything with it? Kinda, but let's see. You see, this location on the stack is where the local variable modified is stored. You can see that because the value 0 is moved to it, like in the C code. And this here is the buffer on the stack. You can see that because the address of it is passed to gets, like in the C code. So when you look at this, you notice that the modified variable is not located after the buffer anymore. We can write as many characters as we want, but we will never overwrite modified. You can also try to reorder the variables in the C code, but that has no effect on the assembler code either. And that's not a coincidence. Buffers or arrays are risky compared to simple integer variables. Buffers are prone to buffer overflows. So the compiler made the decision to order the local variables in a particular way. And it kinda has something to do with the stack smashing detected message. You see, this message is caused because a stack cookie, or stack canary, or stack guard, was overwritten. So what exactly is that? Let's open the compiled binary in a disassembler to have a better look at it. If you are still learning about the stuff, assembler code always looks very intimidating, but it's all about recognizing and learning patterns. One such pattern is here with the stack cookies. Because when you reverse engineer a program, you can basically ignore a lot of stuff. For example, this here and down here has to do with the stack cookie, and so it has nothing to do with the functionality of the program. If you are interested in what this function roughly does, you can look for functions being called here. So there's a gets, and it's reading something, then a local variable is compared, and then it prints a string with puts in either case. So you already get a rough idea from that, but we already know what it does, so what's up with the part of the stack cookie? In the beginning of the function, a value was moved from a weird place, fs at offset hex 28, into the register rax, and that value is placed onto the stack. At the end of the function, just before the return, this value is read again from the stack, and then xored with this mysterious value in fs hex 28. This is just to check if the two values are the same. If they are equal, the function is allowed to return. If the check failed, and those values are different, then there's a call to stack check fail, and the program will never return. And this makes sense, right? So some unknown value is written onto the stack at the beginning, then stuff happens, for example gets call, which can overflow the buffer, and at the end the value on the stack is compared again to this mysterious value. So if we had a buffer overflow that overwrote the stack cookie, the check would fail. So FS or GS or other segment registers are special registers with varying usage depending on 32-bit or 64-bit, and if you're on Windows or Linux, or if you write low-level boot kernel ring 0 code, or if you write user space ring 3 programs. And there's a lot of historical baggage with them. And to be completely honest with you, I don't fully understand it. Maybe somebody in the comments can correct me and add some additional information. So take this explanation with a grain of salt. You can imagine the FS register to point to some memory. And from the perspective of the process, we actually don't really know where it points to. The kernel, I think, sets up where it points to. So the process doesn't really care where it points to, it just uses it. And it can then reference different values at certain offsets in that memory. So for example, the stack cookie is stored at the offset hex 28. And actually, the location must be somewhere in the virtual memory of the process as well. Let's install GDB enhancement PIDA really quickly because it has a great memory find function. We can test this by setting a breakpoint at the stack cookie handling routines and search the process memory for this stack value. And you can see it shows up in some kind of memory. And if you check the memory maps, it is included here. And that is really the location where FS points to, because for example, we can now overwrite this value with hex 41, so capital AAA, and when we continue and enter a lot of data, a lot of A's, we will overwrite the cookie on the stack with hex 414141. And when we now reach the end of the code, the stack cookie value was obviously overwritten by us with 414141. But we also just set by hand the original value of the stack cookie to 414141. And even though we cannot inspect to see where FS points to, the CPU knows where the value is and will compare those two now. And not surprisingly, we continue to the return and get a stack fault, instead of getting the stack check fail. This means we actually have changed the original value of the stack cookie. That's cool, huh? But you see, it's not really a bypass for cookies. It doesn't help us in this particular case and magically make it exploitable. We are just playing around with it to understand it better. And we know that the original stack cookie value is stored somewhere in memory. So those cookies serve a precise purpose, but it's not the magic medicine that stops every exploit attempt. But now you have a better understanding of the limitations of stack cookies. They are just a value on a stack which are placed there at the beginning of a function and compared to the original value before the function returns. This means we can overwrite the return point on the stack, but the issue is that the function will never return because the stack cookie is wrong. And if there are other variables on the stack before the cookie, they could still be overwritten. So it actually just kind of protects you from smashing the return pointer for a classical buffer overflow. It only stops the function from returning, but it might not stop other side effects due to the things overwritten on the stack. So in our case, theoretically, if the modified variable would have been placed after the buffer, we could have still overwritten it without ever writing so far that we overwrite the stack cookie. But the compiler developers know that buffer overflows are a common thing, so they want buffers to be as close as possible to the stack cookie, which causes the modified and buffer variable to be reordered in this way. The buffer is placed after the modified variable, closer to the cookie. Darn it. There's another interesting thing about stack cookies. Let's rerun the program and collect a few random cookies. Do you notice something? They all start with a 0 byte. So this is the little endian format, but in memory the bytes would look like this. So that's interesting. Why would they not use all 8 bytes for random values, but compromise one of these bytes to be a static 0? Doesn't that make it weaker, because now you only have to brute force, guess, 7 bytes? There are obviously various ways how you can attack stack cookies. It obviously should not be guessable or brute forcible, but 7 bytes is a huge number already, so probably good enough. But as you know, there are a lot of ways to leak values from memory, for example with format string exploits. So you use that to leak a stack cookie value, and then your overflow is trivial again. But some overflows happen because of a string copy, and strings in C are zero terminated. So even if you would know the stack cookie and you have a vulnerable string copy, you can never overwrite the cookie with the correct value because you cannot write a 0 byte, because a null byte marks the end of a string in C. But our example uses gets, and according to the man page, you can see that gets actually only stops at a new line. So you could write a null byte with that. So it's a very clever choice to include a null byte in the cookie. It's an additional protection against string copies, even if the cookie value is known. But maybe you ask yourself, what about 32-bit? Is there also a byte used for a null byte? Let's find out. To compile a 32-bit program on 64-bit, you have to install some other stuff. And we can also quickly check if this is not exploitable. And you can see that we also only get the stack smash protection error. Okay, so let's extract some stack cookies here. You can see that a different segment register is used here on 32-bit, but same concept. And who would have thought? Also a 0 byte in it. So this makes only 3 bytes of randomness. 16 million possible values. That sounds a bit more scary. 16 million, depending on the context where and how the program is run, is not much. Maybe in our case, it might actually make it exploitable. I mean, the original Protostar VM was also 32-bit, so I think it's fair game. But to be fair, 64-bit probably makes it unexploitable. So the plan is clear. We write a program that calls this 32-bit version of stack level 0 all the time and send an exploit string to it, which uses a random cookie value to brute force it. And at some point we might get lucky, guess the correct cookie value, overflow the return pointer, and redirect code execution to the output, the if case we want. Well, the plan sounds good, if it were just this easy. We will need a bit more time for this, so let's do it in another video. But it's a fun challenge, so you should try that at home.